the sign of the time when the bishop preaches from the iPad, right? Dear friends, it is with great joy that we gather here at Our Lady of the Nativity to invoke God's blessing upon this newly rebuilt church, a symbol of our enduring hope in hard times. It is a celebration of the indomitable human spirit, the resilience and the courage of this community in reaching out for a better future, notwithstanding all things to the contrary. It is the same spirit, resilience and courage that will help rebuild not just a physical building with brick and mortar, but the community of faith called the church. You know, when Pope Francis began his pontificate at the papal inauguration, the people gathered at St. Peter's Square, and many of them carried banners that read, "Go and rebuild my church." It was, of course, a reference to St. Francis' dream in which he was told to rebuild the church, which was falling into ruins. Pope Francis, like his namesake, has since dedicated himself to the task. It was such a power symbol when he bowed and asked the people for their blessing upon his Petrine ministry. It was a powerful symbol of a humble, listening and accompanying church, the new wine of God's unconditional love, boundless mercy, radical inclusivity and equality needs to be poured into the new wineskins of humility, mutuality, compassion, powerlessness, the old wineskins of triumphalism, supremacy, abetted by clerical power, superiority and rigidity are now broken. The servant leadership of Pope Francis is indicative of the new era of hope, even if we are struggling to find our way in the emerging and unfamiliar landscape. Transition times are inevitably full of chaos, uncertainty, and even confusion. As the Holy Spirit leads us in a new exodus, we are called to go forward into the future with courage, with hope. We need to remember that the tough times can be the blessed times. The church was not at its best, as some might think, nostalgically, when it reached the heights of imperial power in what was known as Christendom. The church, instead, was at its best when it was poor, persecuted, and powerless. Consistently, we, the true believers, are challenged to be the beacons of hope in the midst of pain, suffering, and despair. God's ways often involve the pain of letting go, beginning again, going forwards, even with uncertainty and chaos. And the Word of God this Sunday helps us to come to terms with our present situation and live it with such courage, faith, and hope. It talks about times of upheaval and change, times of cleansing and purification. But it also encourages us to be vigilant, to hold firm and never lose heart. In the first reading, the prophet Malachi speaks about the burning anger of God. He uses apocalyptic language to describe the day of judgment. The wicked will be burnt like stubble, but the sun of righteousness will shine like the sun is shining today on the just with its healing rays. It was common for the prophets of the Old Testament to speak about good and evil, rewards and punishment in this way. What we can learn from Malachi is that God continues to purify his people, and he often uses pain and suffering as a means to test and cleanse us in order to make us more authentic, more true to our calling. And therefore we should not fear and shirk from testing times. Rather, we should embrace and grow through them. In the Gospel, Jesus talks about the impending crisis in terms of the challenges and adversities that his disciples must be prepared to face. Metaphorically, he speaks of the destruction of the old temple, which will be the catalyst for a new Israel. The crisis that the death of the old will create will also bring believers an opportunity to bear witness to the new. The end time is not doom and gloom for those who believe. In fact, it can also be a blessing in disguise, the moment of purification and maturity of faith. So brothers and sisters here at Lawson, just like the early Jewish Christians, we are told to take heart and to discern the way of God in times of crisis. The metaphor of the death of the old temple becomes relevant for us as we witness an emerging church from the ashes of the sexual abuse crisis and its lightning rod, the Royal Commission. Our churches may not be destroyed, may not be razed to the ground like the temple in Jerusalem that Jesus spoke about. But in many ways, the death of the old way of being church is already evident for all to see. Our reputation, our moral credibility, our trust capital are effectively destroyed. Destroyed in the wake of the sexual abuse crisis, and which in itself is a vestige of the old triumphalist, clericalist, innocent, self-sufficient, self-contained fortress church. And let us not be afraid of the death of the old. Let our hearts expand and accommodate the ways of God, and let us become catalysts for renewal and transformation through our commitment and our engagement with the gospel values. Let us learn the art of living deeply in God's love, attentive to his presence and the times, the signs of the times, and responsive to those signs of the times. Then we can be the conduits of mercy and a sign of hope for all.